Hey folks, next video on my do-it-yourself milling machine project here. And in today's video, I will take you with me and show you all the details here I've mounted since last time. And I will also show you how I align everything, and we will have a look at the final accuracy of this thing here. But before we start, I want to show you some assembly footage. Let's start at the top of the Z-axis here. Here's of course the servo motor, 750 watt for Z, and an external brake directly on the ball screw here, because I got this motor used and it didn't have a brake on it. Here are the lubrication lines for the two carrier here and the ball screw. Here's the sensor for the Z-axis home position. I will use the index mark on the linear scale, so this is only to tell the machine where it is roughly positioned. It indicates against the carrier here. Here's a pneumatic piston to support the Z-axis a little bit. It's not really needed, but it won't hurt. I will put a constant pressure on this here, so it will have a constant force counteracting the weight of the Z-axis here. And here's the cable chain for Z, relatively big, so I will not run into space issues. Oh, that's pretty much everything on this side here. For now, I will just use this block here for lubrication with grease ports for every lubrication line. Maybe I will change it out in the future against an automatic system, but that's the easiest and cheapest way for now. So let's go over to the other side of the Z-axis. Not so much space here. Okay, here's the linear scale for Z. The reader head is mounted to the column, so the cable won't move. This linear scale has a resolution of 0.5 micrometer, so 1 micrometer would have been enough, but I got this cheap, so it won't hurt to have a little bit higher resolution here. And also here on the top is a limit switch, like this one down here. These limit switch I have installed on every axis, and they are directly connected to the servo drive. So it is independent of the control software, and if something goes wrong with the control software, the motor will still stop when it hits the limit switch here. I printed a little actuator here to actuate it, and that works pretty good. And the servo drive breaks the axis pretty fast, so this will save my machine if something goes wrong. And yeah, that's pretty much all on the column here. The cable mess here, I have to tidy that up. And let's have a look at the XY assembly here. Here you can see that I printed such little holder to manage all the lubrication lines here. They're going down through this cable change here for the X-axis. And here is again an actuator for the limit switch over here. The X-axis linear scale is mounted to the table, and the reader head is mounted to the plate down here. So again, the cable only has to go through one cable chain, just to minimize movements on cables here. And down here, or maybe up here, here the limit switch for Y. And the second one is down here. And I used a bent piece of aluminium to actuate those. And this is relatively flexible, so the switch won't get damaged when the axis moves a little bit further than the switching point. And for the XY plate combination here, I have two cable chains, one here and one on the other side. And I have spacer pieces here in the cable chain, so everything is nice and tidy in here. And as you can see, there's still a little bit of room here for future things I don't know yet, so it doesn't hurt to have some space in the cable chains here. And this is the limit switch wire. Here on the front, it wasn't that easy to get all the lubrication lines over to this side here. I had to get a little bit creative because there the fixed bearing side of the Y-axis ball screw is in the way, so I have to go up here. And let's have a look at the other side here. Here is the X-axis motor, and that's the Y-axis linear scale cable. And the linear scale for X is mounted here. And again, the linear scale is moving. And the reading head, you can see down there, is stationary. So this cable does not have to go through a cable chain. And in this cable chain, there are a lot of more cables actually, not tubes. Here for the X-axis servo motor, the linear scale cable and limit switches. The reference switch for the X-axis is positioned here, so it indicates against the plate here. But as I said on set already, these are only there to tell the control software roughly where the machine is positioned, and then it will take the index point on the linear scale here. Those index points on these scales are every 50 millimeters, so I have to tell the control software somehow where the machine is roughly. And for the Y-axis, the sensor is here and goes against the carrier here. I think that's pretty much all about the machine itself here. The control software is also already working, and I can move everything here slowly and also faster. but you already saw that in the last video. And I want to show you quickly the control cabinet. That's not completely finished now, it's a little bit messy at the moment, and it will go under there to maximize the space efficiency. I have the three servo drives here, a 24 volt power supply. Here's the Mesa card, and that's a 7i76E, and that's a 7i85, as you can read there, for the linear scales. Here's a small all-in-one PC to control everything, a little fan there. The switch has to get in there, and two or three buttons at the front. I have a main actuator here to turn on the power for the whole control cabinet. So if the power goes out and comes again, this won't be on, and I always have to press the button in the front here to turn on the machine. Here's another contactor over there that will go to the spindle drive, which is not in this control cabinet here, so I can turn it off. That's also this switch here, just if I want to be sure that the spindle won't turn, I can turn this off here. Here's a safety switch, which switches some safety mechanism. Here are some relays to switch various stuff like the brake for the Z-axis and so on. The spindle driver will go in this space here. I will build a little control cabinet here because it's quite a big one, and that's the easiest way to fit everything together here. So let's have a look at how I aligned everything here. The rails and the column I already showed in another video, because I just scraped in all the surfaces and they align perfectly if I just screw everything together here. Another thing will be the spindle here. I haven't mounted it yet, but that's just tilting in this direction to get it perpendicular to the table, and shimming it down there or up there to tilt it probably in this direction for the to get it perpendicular to the table here. But that's a very easy task. And you might ask if it's important how the column is rotated accordingly to the Y rays here, but that's not really important. So I just screwed the column down there, aligned it flush with the metal insert in the base concrete part, and that's good enough. The next thing, or pretty much the only left thing to do, is to align the Y-axis down here perpendicular to the X-axis. And therefore, I have to move the table to the complete limit, like that. And down here, you can see that I can still reach all the screws that mount the XY assembly to the carriers down here. And it also looks the same when I move the table to the other side. And that way I can loosen all these screws, put a square on the table here, and mount an indicator up here on the Z-axis, just because it's the easiest way to do. Indicate one side of the square, and I have to indicate the X-axis side first. No, I have to indicate the Y-axis side, that will go this way first. And then I can switch the indicator to the other side that indicates the X-axis. And I can move the base plate here, or rotate the base plate until the indicator shows zero on the X-axis side. and then y and x are aligned perfectly square. And this is pretty much everything I have to do to align everything here. The other things are that the table here, of course, has to be flat and parallel. So the top surface here is also flat and parallel according to the x-axis, well, c-axis. But that's the case here, so that's pretty much all. I think that machine can be pretty accurate, at least after those measurements here. And that's all for today's video. If you liked it, please give it a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe. See you next time.